Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship here at First Presbyterian Church of Farmington. Reminder that Sunday schools will start each Sunday at their usual time of 9:15, but Bonnie, I forgot to ask. We're doing Sunday school during Spoon River, correct?
Yes.
Okay, so. The Sailboat Church book discussion is continuing on Mondays at 6 p.m. You're welcome to join. We will be celebrating communion in worship next Sunday. However, it's hard to get around to some of the places where our folks live for home communion during Spoon River. So we're going to wait until November. But if you know someone who really is going to miss it, let me know and I'll come a different day of the week. No fellowship next Sunday and the Sunday after. We invite you to enjoy the Spoon River food. Choir is going to rehearse on October 9th.
No.
We're
rehearsing this Wednesday, October 2nd, but not on the 9th.
Not on the 9th. October 2nd. Not the 9th. The 16th. All right. And singing on the 20th. Yay. Okay. The 2nd and the 16th, not on the 9th, singing on the 20th. For anybody on Facebook that needs to know that. The celebration of life for Sam Rutledge will be held this afternoon at the Farmington Moose Lodge from 1 p.m. to 4 p.m. And if you volunteered to bring desserts, I think we're supposed to take them over. Kathy?
I'll pick them up here.
Okay, you'll pick them up at
noon.
At noon.
Well,
gotcha. Okay. Mark your calendar for a couple of upcoming events. October 27th, we're going to have a potluck, and we're going to be collecting donations for the Farmington Food Pantry. November 16th, we're having a soup supper open to the community from 4 to 7 p.m. Of course, the community can always come for any event, but that one especially from 4 to 7 on the 16th, it's a soup supper, and it's going to go to pay for guardians to go on the honor flights. And food pantry is on November 20th from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. If you can work that, let us know. Other announcements? Hearing none, I invite you, if you would like, to stand, and we will pass the peace of Christ. If you opt out, just remain seated. The peace of Christ be with you. I invite you to return to your seats and stand if you are able. And we will join in our call to worship. Upon this gathering of your people, pour out your Spirit, O Lord. Be near to us and speak to us, and we will proclaim your glory. Our opening hymn is number 331, God of the Ages, whose almighty hand.
Amen.
have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. In humility and faith, let us confess our sins to God. Let us pray. God of unity, we live in a world where our lives move between inclusivity and exclusivity. We often move toward the latter, trying to oust from our circles those who do not think like us, act like us, or look like us. Forgive our need to reject and to always be on the lookout for those things that make us different. Give us the eyes of our teacher, who knows unconditional love and compassion and sees us all as one. For it is in his name that we pray. Amen. Hear the good news. Who is in a position to condemn? Only Christ. And Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. Christ prays for us. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life has gone. A new life has begun. Know that you are forgiven and be at peace. Amen. Something I like to have with it. Can you guess what it is? What do I like to put on my steak? Anybody? No guesses?
Horseradish.
57
sauce.
57 sauce. Horseradish sauce.
Ketchup.
Ketchup.
Nothing.
Ranch?
Yeah, I was
waiting
for that one.
Yeah. Flaky sea salt. Flaky sea salt. Yeah, and I learned to do that quite a while ago. And the other day, my younger son and his wife made steak tacos for the whole house. And he said to his wife, "Remember the flaky sea salt. We got to have it." So anyhow, try it sometime. Pretty good. It's not flaky sea salt is not cheap, but like Costco sells it, and you can get it sometimes in a small quantity, and it's a little splurge. So salt is something that's important in the Bible. Did you know that? It is. Shows up in our passage today, and it talks about how we need to essentially be like salt. Salt has been used for years and years and years to make food last for a long time. Have you ever had salami? Have you had pepperoni? You have pepperoni on your pizza sometime, right? Uh-huh. Let's see, what else? Beef jerky. Yeah, absolutely, beef jerky. Do you know how you can make those? You take meat, and you put it in salt, or you put a lot of salt around it, you put a casing on it, put salt in it, and salt draws a lot of the moisture out. Because like when you have a hamburger, it's juicy, right? When you have a chicken breast, it's juicy. When you have fish, it can be juicy. But if you put it in salt, it takes all that moisture out, and that makes it so that the things that make it go rotten can't live in there, like bacteria and things like that. So salt actually preserves the life of something, makes it last longer. And salt is part of what we need to be like to preserve our life, to preserve the good things in us. Okay? So there's a lot of other references to salt in Scripture. But Jesus tells us, stay salty. Okay? Stay salty. All right. Ready for prayer? Put your hands together. Close your eyes. Bow your head. Gracious God, we thank you that you teach us about how to be good followers of you using everyday items like bread and juice and salt. Help us to remember to stay salty, to remember to preserve the good stuff in us and in our lives and in our world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, you can go. Gospel lesson for this morning picks up exactly where we left off last week. So hear the good news. This is Mark chapter 9, verses 38 through 50. Hear the good news. John said to Jesus, "Teacher, we saw someone throwing demons out in your name, and we tried to stop him because he wasn't following us." And Jesus replied, "Don't stop him. No one who does powerful acts in my name can quickly turn around and curse me. Whoever isn't against us is for us. I assure you that whoever gives you a cup of water to drink because you belong to Christ will certainly be rewarded. As for whoever causes these little ones who believe in me to trip and fall into sin, it would be better for them to have a huge stone hung around their necks and to be thrown into the lake. If your hand causes you to fall into sin, chop it off. It's better for you to enter into life crippled than to go away with two hands into the fire of hell, which can't be put out. If your foot causes you to fall into sin, chop it off. It's better for you to enter life lame than to be thrown into hell with two feet. If your eye causes you to fall into sin, tear it out. It's better for you to enter God's kingdom with one eye than to be thrown into hell with two. That's a place where the worms don't die and the fire never goes out. Everyone will be salted with fire. Salt is good. But if salt loses its saltiness, how will it ever become salty again? Maintain salt among yourselves and keep peace with one another. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So we're going to run through the scripture with our sermon again this week, but I wanted to remind you that last week, at the end of the scripture lesson, Jesus has a child in his lap, and he says, "Whoever welcomes the child welcomes me and the one who sent me." Okay? That's the last thing he said. And the whole purpose of last week was Jesus was trying to get the disciples to stop focusing on themselves and stop focusing on human matters and think about godly things, okay? So that's where we left off. Child in his lap, whoever welcomes the child welcomes me, welcomes the one who sent me. And get over yourselves, okay? So what do? Brady, can you put that up? John interrupts and says, we saw so many, he goes right to human stuff, right into it. He says, we saw someone throwing demons out in your name and we tried to stop him because he isn't one of us. If you're Jesus, you just gotta be pulling your hair out. Come on, man. Telling you. So, here's the thing. We like to know that we belong to the right group, don't we? Don't we want to believe that we belong to the right group, especially in today's world? Oh my goodness. Oh, we pick groups against each other constantly. Let's go to the next verse. Jesus said, don't stop him. No one who does powerful acts in my name can quickly turn around and curse me. Because who's doing it? Who's doing that? When we have a baptism, I sprinkle water. Who does the baptism? I heard somebody say it. Oh, but yeah, John the Baptist did it for Jesus, and when Jesus did it, Yeah, God. God's doing it. Jesus was doing it all over the place with the power and help of God and the Holy Spirit. John the Baptist did it with the help of God and the Holy Spirit, right? It's not me. It's not me. I say the words. I let God do it. God's the one that makes the mark. Not me. But boy. Boy, we so want to limit God. Next slide. Whoever isn't against us is for us. Remind me what the next verse is. Okay. I assure you that whoever gives you a cup of water to drink because you belong to Christ will certainly be rewarded. Okay. So let's talk a little bit about this whole who belongs and who doesn't belong. And let's talk about competitiveness. Because this is going to come up real quick. So, we're Presbyterian. I'm Presbyterian. Not everybody here is Presbyterian. But I'm Presbyterian. Lily's grandma, her Mimi. Mimi goes to church, right? Mimi has a church. Mimi has a church. I'm not sure what denomination it is or if it's non-denominational. But in Mimi's church, we've had this conversation in the fellowship hall. Well, actually, we were going through my office and we had this conversation because we celebrated Thanksgiving here last year because my best friend's in a wheelchair and couldn't get into the manse or our son's home. So we had Thanksgiving here. And I took Mimi and her husband and Lily's cousins on a tour, and it dawned on their youngest daughter that I was the pastor. And she said to Mimi, to her mom, well, she could come and be at our church. And I said, no, I couldn't. I can't, because in that church, women can't be pastors. That I knew. Okay, I knew that Well, I don't know exactly what branch it is. I know that women can't be pastors in that church. She goes, oh, well, that's weird. And I said, but it's okay. It's okay. I don't, you know, I wanted her to know that I'm okay with it, because who's doing the work? God. And so, well, I prefer to worship, and I feel called to participate in a denomination where women can be leaders. That doesn't mean that God isn't working in that church. Right? This is the part of what Jesus is trying to get through. If amazing things are happening, if you're learning about faith, if healing is being done and whatnot, okay. You know, what one person feels called to by God to do may not be the same thing. I may not be traveling the same path as that person. Mimi's on a great faith path. It's really doing amazing things for her, especially when she's in tough times. God's calling me to a different path, and it's okay. Because whoever gives someone a cup of water to drink, especially when you belong to Christ, will be rewarded. You don't even have to be, that person doesn't even have to be a member of a church. They don't have to be somebody who's claimed Jesus as their Lord and Savior. It doesn't say that. It says if they give you a cup of water because they know you're Christian and they want to help, that they get a reward. The reward might be that they understand the importance of Christ, even if they're not there yet. Next. Okay, here we go. Hang on. As for whoever causes these little ones, remember he's got a child sitting there, but it doesn't just mean that. Whoever causes these little ones, it can be someone who's immature in faith. There's other places in the gospel where we're led to believe he's also talking about that. Whoever causes a little one who believes in me to trip and fall into sin, it would be better for them to have a huge stone hung around their necks and be thrown into a lake, aka drown. This big stuff. This is big, big stuff. Okay. I'm gonna go back to this as we go on. I'm gonna take us back, but keep going. If your hand causes you to fall into sin, chop it off. It's better for you to enter into life crippled than to go away with two hands into the fire of hell, which can't be put out. Next one. If your foot causes you to fall into sin, chop it off. It's better for you to enter life lame than to be thrown into hell with two feet. Next one. If your eye causes you to fall into sin, tear it out. It's better for you to enter God's kingdom with one eye than to be thrown into hell with two. Here's the thing. The foot can take you places you don't want to go. The hand can reach places where you shouldn't. The eye can make you gaze at something with malicious intent. That's the heart of the matter here. So, if you're getting competitive and you want to make sure that you're in the smallest, selectest, best group to belong to, you'll want to keep the group small. Back then, the disciples really wanted to. They wanted to know they were getting in. They wanted to know that they were going to be among the greatest. They were making huge sacrifices. And this was getting to be a big honking deal. Human nature was getting a better hold of them than Jesus' teaching was. And so that when someone is able to do something that they couldn't, or they could do it, but this person hasn't made the same kind of sacrifices that they have, that just rubs them the wrong way. Why is it okay? Why can they do that? That doesn't make sense. We've done all this work, we've done all this traveling, we've given up our lives, we've given up income, we're following you. We know that our lives might be at stake somewhere along the way because there's getting to be a little rumbling going on here. But come on, that's okay? It's okay that this thing makes us less special? That doesn't seem right. And so he knows human nature. Jesus knows human nature. Let's take people down a notch. Do we like to do that in our culture today? Take people down a notch? Make ourselves feel better? Because, you know, we're putting a lot of work into it. And Jesus says, listen, that is not what this is about. If you think that that's what this is about, you are barking up the wrong tree, and it's much better that you just die and be done. It's better that you get rid of the thing that's taking you down the wrong path. Come on. This is about big dream, big world, big kingdom. Everybody, anybody, come on. The more people doing it, the better. The more people doing this, the better. Yeah, our churches are shrinking. We don't like that. But if there's other churches that are growing and they're making a difference, not the same way we would, okay. It'd be nice if we grew too, but don't look to take them down a notch. Cheer them on and keep doing what we do, knowing that God is going to help us, because who's doing it? God. But boy, our society hates that right now. Really doesn't like it right now. There's got to be a winner and there's got to be a loser. There's got to be looking for all the dirt, right? Aren't we always looking for the dirt in this culture right now? Especially in an election season. So let's talk a little bit about HEW hockey sticks.
Yes.
Yes.
I've been waiting for this.
Okay.
I have children. We talk about sin a lot. I'm ready. Let's do this.
Okay. Okay. So let's talk about it. I went down and made a few notes before to make sure. Okay. There are different words for hell. We're talking about a theological concept. So, theological means a God. It's a God concept, something that God teaches about, right? God isn't the only one. In Hebrew, there is a word for hell called Sheol. Okay? That word, translated into Greek, is Hades. There is another Greek word for hell. It's the one in this passage. It's called Gehenna, spelled G-H-E-N-N-A. It is from an Old Testament word. Oh, let me back up. Sheol and Hades is the place of the dead. The place of the dead. That's what that is. That's what God teaches the people about in the Old Testament. Gehenna comes from an Old Testament story, particularly one in 2 Chronicles. Chapter 28, verses 1 through 3. This is the place of punishment. Okay? So the way that some people think about it is Sheol or Hades is a place for the dead, and at the time of judgment, you may end up in Gehenna. You might end up in the place of punishment. There's some talk about whether or not that's a metaphorical understanding at the time that this was taught, or whether or not it is literal. Hard for us to know. What I know is I see people experiencing hell on earth. I definitely see that. So let's talk about this one, the word that's being used here over and over again, Gehenna. So it was a ravine south of Jerusalem that was notorious for pagan infanticide. The Canaanites worshipped Baal, and they also worshipped a fire god called Molech, Molech. Okay. So what they did was they would sacrifice their children to satisfy the god Baal, to bring good things upon them when life was going badly. And they would also do it in the manner that would satisfy the fire god, Molech. They did this in this spot, and the fire never went out. They always kept it going. Okay? That's a horrible thing. It is against everything that the God we worship believed in. But there was even a king of Israel, Ahaz, who got really worried about whether or not the one true God, that's what they would call God, what the one true God was going to come through for them or not. And he felt like, well, okay, let's play all the possibilities. So he even allowed people, believers, to sacrifice their children at this spot. And God said, no, this is not okay. That's what Gehenna is. That's the name. It's the Vale of Hinnom. And this is the closest translation the Greek comes to for the name of the Vale of Hinnom. Okay? So that's where this comes from. Pretty awful story, isn't it? That's what he's talking about. That's.
But there's also the lake of fire.
Correct, from Revelation.
There's also the Abraham's bosom.
There is.
Which is.
Yes. Yep.
The prophet, one of the disciples actually stood.
Yes.
And saw across the lake.
Yes.
And saw the people burning.
Yes. Yes, exactly. Here's the thing I went to do. I knew. So I was like, I had enough of my own stuff that I knew, and I made sure I wrote down a couple of my own little notes, and I thought this morning, I said, no, I gotta get my I's dotted and my T's crossed. And so yeah, there's one more.
One more, huh?
Old Testament image. Abraham.
There's Abraham's bosom.
No. Yeah, there's Abraham's bosom. There's one more. There's the lake of fire in Revelation. I don't think I wrote it down. Hang on, let me see if I did.
Brielle wants to know if it's the one where the people in heaven can see the people in hell. Do you know where that's from? That was talking about Abraham's bosom. So that's probably the same one.
Yeah.
Okay.
It, It's sitting out on my counter down in the office. So, okay. So the one thing that I went to go see was whether or not the lake of fire burning with brimstone that's in Revelation and appears, I think it's five times, maybe, I think it's five. Gehenna, the one that we're talking about, appears 12 times. And other than James 3:6, the only person to talk about it is Jesus. Revelation, I think it's five or six times. And I went to go look for the root word to see if it was, and I could not find it. I have what's called an interlinear, for those of you who are interested. It's a word-by-word translation from the Greek into English. And mine is in Carbondale. And it's not here. I went looking for it. Then there's another website that I go to called So Much Bible that does word studies and does that same sort of literal translation from both Greek and Hebrew. That's a site run by two Presbyterian ministers, husband and wife. The wife does most of the work for that. She didn't have it. So I have to get back to you on it, whether or not the lake of fire is the same thing as Gehenna. It sounds like it is. It's still talking about a place of eternal punishment. So, yeah. More than you wanted to know about hell? No?
Not enough.
Not enough. True. It's true.
Yeah. Side of it as well as the good side of it.
Yeah. Jesus talks about it as a possibility that is going to happen when he judges folks.
What's
so,
What's going to happen? We can't hear what they're saying.
Oh, you're right. Shoot.
We don't have to.
They can't hear. So we're talking about whether or not we're talking about what the root word is in Revelation, because Revelation is a place where the lake of fire is talked about like five or six times. I don't know if it's the same word that we're talking about in this scripture passage. So there's the deep curiosity to know if it's the same, and if it's possible to think that you can have the good without the bad. So can you have heaven without hell? Can you have a life that that would possibly, you could do horrible things and not have to pay for it? That's the deep question, right?
You don't have to.
He
said, but you can't keep doing the bad things.
So you still have to, so no matter what, you still have to have heaven and hell. But you can't, even if you accept Christ, you still understand that you are accepting Christ while knowing that you are not going to another place then. Like, it's not only heaven. Like, you can't, you have to still understand, because it's very clearly written in the Bible that there is another place that non-believers would go.
Correct. Okay, so she's saying that that you can accept Christ, but you also got to know that there's the reality of the possibility of hell, because the Bible says there's a place for eternal punishment, a place of like a fire. Yeah, well, that is a thing. That is a thing that offends a lot of people, is that possibility of, could you do it at the moment of judgment?
I think there's a difference between saying you're doing it and actually meaning that you're doing it. until that last moment, it's hard to tell if they actually mean that they're accepting him. You know what I mean? Or mm-hmm. if it's something they say in hopes that that works out.
Well, here's the thing. Can you go back to the verse with the water? I mean, because that's the thing that it's like, I assure you that whoever gives a cup of water to drink, gives you a cup of water to drink because you belong to Christ will certainly be rewarded, is that there's not a lot of clarity about that. Yes, sir.
Yeah, there is clarity. So it actually says in the Bible,
yes.
And that's a very Catholic take on it, too.
Yes.
I believe that if you have so many
correct.
Good rewards, then it will
get right, but is it good for all time if you're wondering about that? I personally think that this is going to be, well, I said to Diana, we've been getting done early every week, so we can wait till 10:30 to start playing. We're not going to get done early. Okay, so we'll do more sermons on this. How about that? Okay. All right. We will do that. I was leaning towards doing a sermon series on Old Testament scriptures that Jesus quotes in his teachings. But if we're going to do Revelation, that doesn't have that. So I'll figure it out. Okay.
We want fire-eyed Jesus over here.
You what?
We want fire-eyed Jesus over here.
You want fire-eyed Jesus?
Yeah, the Revelations with the white
flaming
hair.
Eyes.
Yeah, we want that's
double-edged.
We're looking at, let's be crazy. Let's do it.
Let's be crazy. Let's do it.
Ooh. And I suggest that the pastor carries that microphone around with her. So
yes, okay. Yes, okay. We're going to move on, but if we're getting into controversial sermons, somebody immediately tell me, pick up the microphone, and we'll go. And remind me to do that, and Brady, you'll have to shut this off. Okay? We got to wrap this up. Okay. This also would be a really good Bible study topic, more than... because then you can hear each other around a table. So we'll think about that, too, as a possibility. Let's see what God figures out for us. Next slide. Keep going. Da, 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 da. So it's a place where worms don't die and the fire never goes out. You know where the fire never goes out from. And everyone's going to be salted with fire. Salt is good, but if salt loses its saltiness, how will it become salty again? Maintain salt among yourselves. And this was what I was going to preach about. But God had a different idea. Thank you, Joe. Keep peace with each other. In big letters here on the backside was supposed to be the focus. What have we learned from Jesus about being at peace with others, especially with those who set us on edge? Food for thought. Amen. All right, we are going to join in singing Make Me a Channel of Your Peace, number 753. I invite you to stand if you are able. any birthdays in the house? See ya. Concerns would you like to share this morning? Anybody? Joe, can you get the mic? Thank you. Joe's going to say it. Nope, Missy is.
Just that my ankle will heal correctly and I will slow down and turn on lights in the future and make all the steps, so. And use the handrail. And also Joy, because Brielle medaled yesterday at her cross country meet.
Yes.
And she did not get her best time, but it was a really, really hard course because it was really uphill and really downhill, so.
Congratulations. Oh, Brielle?
We kind of had a God sighting yesterday. We almost got hit by a train.
Oh no.
It was in Monmouth, but we got out in time. So I kind of said that's a joy because we had a God sighting that we didn't get hit by the train.
Yeah, that is one big old God sighting. Not getting hit by a train is very important.
Well, let's just explain the context.
Okay.
Okay. So we're waiting. There's two train tracks, right? One may be going one way, one may be going the other way. So we've crossed the train tracks thousands of times. This is the first time it's ever happened to me. We had two cars in front of us waiting for the first train to go by. It was like carrying cargo and all that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
The lights stop. Train passes by. The arms come up. We're looking left. We're looking right. Okay, time to go. Two cars in front start going across the tracks. The second car is off the tracks, first set of tracks going on to the next set, and we're behind that second car. We're third, and the lights turn back on.
Oh.
And the guard thing starts coming down, and I look behind me, and the truck's behind me, almost to the track. And so I had to speed up and go around so the guard doesn't come down and hit the vehicle we're in as well. Don't hit the car in front of me. The track that's furthest from us had a passenger. What do you call it?
Amtrak?
An Amtrak type.
Yeah.
It was going faster.
Oh, they go fast. Yeah.
It was going faster than the other train, so we got off in probably 10, 15 seconds before the other train.
The truck behind us, the guardrail thing, came down on that truck.
And yeah.
Yeah, it was scary.
Luckily, no one got hurt.
Yeah.
Good.
It was bad timing.
Yes. Somebody needs to report that. Yeah. Wow. Okay. Yes, Cozy.
I'll just ask for prayers on Tuesday. Hope the surgery goes well.
Okay. Is this your aortic valve?
This is pacemaker.
Okay.
Mickey and I had a real joy Friday.
Yeah.
We got to celebrate 55 years of marriage.
I was trying to figure out, like, were you of legal age? Okay. Okay, who else? All right. Thank you, Joe. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for fabulous joys. We thank you for birthdays and anniversaries. We thank you for good track meets. And oh my goodness, are we so thankful that nobody was hurt at that train crossing. We especially ask that you be with Sam's family as they prepare to receive people, as they share their greetings, their concerns, their appreciation for the Rutledge family. We know that it may feel overwhelming to them, but we pray that you give them the strength and the energy that they need for this afternoon. We thank you for our opportunity today to dive a little more deeply, but maybe not quite deep enough into into Gehenna, into our scripture lesson today. I pray forgiveness for not understanding that not everyone could hear. Help us always to remember to work for inclusivity. Gracious God, we ask that you be with us in this, what promises to be a beautiful and yet very busy week ahead. We pray that people will make wise decisions as the community prepares to receive thousands of people in the coming days. Most of all, we thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, who has so many lessons to teach us through Scripture, and we thank you for his presence in our lives, and we thank you for the Holy Spirit, and most of all, we thank you, God. And we ask that you hear the prayer that we lift now that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Through loving deeds and generous acts, we become a blessing to others and give honor to Christ's name. What greater reward could we ask than to share in God's saving work? Let us now bring forth our gifts.
Thank you.
join me in prayer. Blessed be the Lord, for God is good, and God's love endures forever. Our Creator, help us to mirror your goodness through this offering in the world. Amen. Our closing hymn is O4 World, number 372. If it had not been for the Lord who was on our side, we would not have been freed or blessed. Do not be a stumbling block, be salt. Have salt in yourselves and be at peace with one another. May God, who is our strength, help us celebrate the freedom we have received and remember his great deeds and grow in trust. May Jesus Christ, in whose name we find power, help us to honor his name with everything we do and say. And may the Holy Spirit, who helps us to pray, motivate in us the practice of prayer, discovering while praying that there is indeed power in the name of Jesus. Amen.